Hello guys, this is the work of Ubinder Singh, that is A History of Ancient and Early Medieval India from the Stone Age to 12th Century. And this book is very familiar and common to all history aspirants and is highly recommended for UPSC History Optional Examination and NTA NET or JRF Examination. Now it's your task to identify the beautiful picture in this cover page. Please comment it in the comment box below. And today onwards, we are going to start the lecture series based on the notes of this work. And today's discussion topic is Stone Age. For more updates, please subscribe my channel and also enable the bell button for instant notification. Let's start. Welcome to History for Exams. As per the syllabus, in this topic, we can see certain important parts such as pastoralism and food production, Neolithic and Chalcolithic phase, their settlements, distributions, tools and patterns of exchange. This is the syllabus given in the syllabus of NTA, NET or JRF in history. So how we can prepare this topic? For the easily crack of NTA, NET or JRF, we can first of all understand certain types of questions asked from this area. No need to be confused. These are certain previous year questions. And in 2018 July examination, we can see this question. Which of the following prehistoric sites is known for the mass production of microliths? Options Adamgarh, Bagar, Nalagonda and Sanganakallu. And 2019 December examination, that is the last one, we can see the earliest evidence of crop production has been found at which of the following Neolithic sites of Indian subcontinent. Options Kilugil Muhammad, Kodjiji, Mehi and Mahargarh. Think of it and try to answer it in the comment box below. From these types of questions, we can come to a conclusion that what to study, that's the enlightenment point. Yes, that is very important for any examination. By analyzing certain previous questions, we can build an insight what to study for this. And from this, we can understand that we have to study certain features of each period and more importantly, uniqueness of important sites. That is very important. Yes guys, that's the importance of my channel, History for Exams. Now you can subscribe. Now let's come to the topic, Stone Age Man. Here we are going to have a basic understanding about a Stone Age Man. He is simply referred as prehistoric man. Now think of who is known as the father of prehistoric India. And we can see during this period or the prehistoric period, the man used stone tools for his survival. And that's why he is simply referred as Stone Age Man. And based on that, we can divide this period mainly into three, that is Paleolithic man, Mesolithic man and Neolithic man. And in the Paleolithic man, that's the oldest stone age in which man was nomadic and practiced hunting life. From there happened certain kind of transition and that transition is simply termed as Mesolithic age or middle age between Paleolithic and Neolithic. And in this Mesolithic period, what we can see from his earliest nomadic way of lifestyle, he began to settle. Earliest settlement can be seen in the Mesolithic period. And from the hunting life, we can see the earliest settlement is going to settle somewhere and practice some kind of agriculture. And in the Neolithic age, that is referred as the agriculture revolution period as per historian Godenchild. And here we can see the man completely began to start his settled life. Now coming to the oldest stone age, Paleolithic age. The term Paleolithic age that was coined by John Lubbock in 1865. And we can see in this picture a man, is Robert Bruce Foote. And he was the first to discover a Paleolithic stone tool from India. And that's why he is referred as father of Indian prehistory. Remember the question that I was asked before. And we can see in the year 1859, he joined the Geological Survey of India. And in the year 1863, he founded or he discovered a stone tool that is simply a hand axe from Pallavaram in Tamil Nadu. And that was his major discovery. And that's why he is known as the father of Indian prehistory. And in the year 1884, he discovered a cave known as Belum Caves. And that is considered as the second largest cave in India. Now think of which is the first largest cave in India. Answer it in the comment box below. And for the convenience of the study, we can divide this Paleolithic age into three broader classification: early Paleolithic, middle Paleolithic and late or upper Paleolithic. The period of corresponding is given here. No need to by heart all things. This is just for understanding the period. The early Paleolithic age. Here we are going to understand or look into certain sites and their significance. The most important among them are given here. Bori in Maharashtra. In Maharashtra, we can see one of the earliest sites and that is earliest local lower value site ever discovered. That is boring. That is very important. And this site suggests that the appearance of human beings in India around 6 lakh years ago. That's why we can understand the period of early Paleolithic begins from 6 lakh years ago. Next one is Sohanian culture, and it is situated in the Sohan River Valley. That's a tributary of Indus, and it is situated in the Sivaliki Hills in the northwestern India and Pakistan. And third one, that is Aquilian or Madrasi culture, and it is named after a French site of Saint Aquil. And here we can see hunter-gatherer culture, that is hunting of animals and gathering or collection of certain fruits. And the most important feature here is that bifacially flaked artifacts can be seen. As you can see in the picture, certain kind of hand axes or cleavers had bifaces. And here the man used quartzite stones and limestone. And the quartzite stone was the hard and durable one and most commonly used raw material. That's why the Paleolithic man also referred as quartzite man. And we can see from Karnataka a site called as Hansgi where the use of limestone in practice. Next is Middle Paleolithic Age, and we can see the spanning period here, and the main characteristics that we can see is the use of weapons made up of chert and jasper, and many sites continued the earlier one, meaning many of the earlier Paleo sites continued here. And the most importantly, we can see the Balan Valley in Uttar Pradesh, and here the stone tools and animal fossils including cattle and deer can be seen. In Rajasthan we can see one near Luni River Valley, and there we can see open air system, and it was a feature of lower Paleolithic and it was continued in this age also. That's about Middle Paleolithic Age. And next is Late Paleolithic Age. In the Late Paleolithic or Upper Paleolithic Age, we can see the appearance of Homo sapiens and new flint industries, means new stone technologies or industries are going to develop in this period. And we can see certain artifacts that reflects art and rituals of period. And in art, the most important thing is the earliest painting in Bimbedka is connected with this Late Paleolithic period. And also the appearance of wide range of bone tools. Remember, it is bone tools, not stone tools, such as needles, fishing tools, harpoons, blades and burying tools also can be seen in this period. Another most important feature of Late Paleolithic or Upper Paleolithic period is that the discovery of ostrich eggshells at over 40 sites in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. As you can see in the picture, board stones, and that is still used by fishermen as net sinkers in fishing, that is developed during this period. And we can see also certain environmental impacts such as extensive formations of deserts in northwestern part of India, and the drainage pattern of western India become almost defunct, and river course shifted westwards. These are the most important two environmental impacts of Upper Paleolithic Age. That's all about the Paleolithic Age in general. After the Paleolithic Age, we can see the transition period called as Middle Stone Culture or also known as the Mesolithic Era. And in this Mesolithic Era, we can see the first human colonization in the Gangetic Plains. And there we can see more than 200 sites found in Uttar Pradesh, such as Allahabad, Pratapgarh, Jaunpur, Mirzapur and Varanasi districts. And in the deltaic regions of Bengal, all these regions we can see certain Mesolithic settlements. And in the early Mesolithic period, we can see certain practices such as hunting, fishing and food gathering, all continuing from the Upper Paleolithic Age. And in the later phase or the late Mesolithic period, we can see a transition towards the Neolithic, that is the early occupations, domestication of animals. And this domestication of animals can be understood from certain bones of cattle, sheep and goat. And the earliest evidence regarding the domestication of animals we can see from at Adamgarh in Madhya Pradesh and Bagor in Rajasthan. These two sites are very important, Adamgarh in Madhya Pradesh and Bagor in Rajasthan. And the unique feature of this period is the use of microliths. Micro means very small and list means stone. Meaning the man in this age began to use the stones or stone tools made up of tiny and small. And the functions of these stone tools were, it used as components of spearheads, as you can see in the picture, arrowheads, knives, sickles, harpoons and daggers. Now let's understand certain important sites of this Mesolithic age. In Rajasthan, we can see the Bagor, and that is the largest Mesolithic site discovered in India. That's the important feature of Bagor. That is the largest Mesolithic site discovered in India. And we can see geometric microlithic industry in this region. Sometimes you'll get question regarding from where we can see the geometric microlithic industry. Answer is Bagor. And from 30 million in BC, we can see the making of handmade pottery in this region. Next is Adamgarh in Madhya Pradesh. And here we can see the presence of both wild and domestic animals. And Adamgarh is famous for or known for mass production of microliths. Remember the question that we asked in the introductory part, that was regarding Adamgarh. Another site is in Gujarat, that is Langraj. And here we can see 7 human skeletons and oldest human skeletal remains in India have been found from here. That's the significance of Langraj in Gujarat. 7 human skeletons and most importantly the oldest human skeletal remains in India that is found from this region. While analyzing certain other features of this period, that is Mesolithic period, we can see certain beginning of traditions such as Mesolithic burials that we can see from Bagor in Rajasthan, Langraj in Gujarat and Bibbedka in Madhya Pradesh. All these regions we can see certain kinds of Mesolithic burials. The Mesolithic man was also a lover of art. The art evidence can be found from Adamgarh and Bibbedka where we can see rock paintings. And these paintings are made mostly in red and white pigments and this red made by minerals of iron oxide and white by limestone. No painting or engraving of snake is found in any Mesolithic site. It's a unique feature of Mesolithic site. That is no painting or engraving of a snake that can be found from any Mesolithic site. Another most important painting that we can see from the painting at Jaora in Madhya Pradesh. And this painting suggests that the world consisting of air, earth and fire. This kind of painting can be found from this Jaora in Madhya Pradesh. And regarding domestication, we can see the first animals to be domesticated were dog, cattle and goat. These are the certain important things regarding Mesolithic period. Next is the most advanced period that is called as Neolithic age or Neolithic culture. The Neolithic culture. The major features of this Neolithic culture will help to understand how the society was. Here we can see domestication of plants and animals, innovation in stone tool technology, hunting towards animal rearing and agriculture, and a food producing society from the earlier food gathering society, invention of pottery and use of wheel, and division of labor based on sex, meaning what? Diversification of occupations, and here man began to start a sedentary or settled way of living. And you can see a picture here that is from Ubinder Singh, that is a pot from Nal, a region from Baluchistan. And from here onwards, we'll be discussing more notes of Ubinder Singh. Now let's look into something very special to the most important Neolithic site, that is Mahargarh, and that is situated in the north of Kachi Plain and near to Bolan Pass or Bolan River Valley, and it consisted an area of 200 hectares. And there we can see 7 occupational levels, and in which the period 1 and 2, that is the occupation level number 1 and 2 belongs to the Neolithic culture, and the Mahargarh 1, that is Neolithic phase 1, that spans between 6000 to 5500 BC. And there we can see the man lived in the houses made up of handmade mud bricks with small rectangular rooms. And the more details of Mahargarh phase 1, basically it was a ceramic, meaning no pottery was there in use. And the burial practices, they buried in open spaces between their houses. Generally, it was in oval pits. And at least in 2 burials, we can see the evidences of young gods. And more copper beads with the burial can also be seen in the phase 1b. And some instances of double burial also practiced in this phase. That's about the Mahargarh phase 1. And coming to the Mahargarh phase 2, that is period 2 of this Neolithic culture, that spans between 6000 and continues till 4500 BCE. There we can see handmade and wheel-made pottery. Look, compared to the first stage, here we can see the invention or the discovery of wheel-made pottery. Also, we can see certain important findings such as copper ring and a small ingot of copper, ivory tusk, grinding stones, small unbaked clay of male torso, and the most important domesticated animal was cattle during this period. This is particular about Mahargarh. Now let's consider certain other northwestern sites. Already we discussed about Mahargarh. Once again, it was the oldest documented evidence towards settled agriculture and bones of cattle, sheep and goat. Earliest domestication evidence can be understood from this. And also we can see the cotton plantation. also started in Mahargarh region. Next was Kiligul Muhammad region, and the inhabitants in this region, they lived in mud houses around 5500 BC, and certain animal remains of cattle, sheep, goat and wild ass are available from this region. Next is Rana Gundai, and it was situated in the Anambar Valley, and it's a semi-nomadic community, and it was around 4500 and continued till 3100 BC. And here we can see certain animals for domestication such as ox, sheep and goat. Next location is Gumla, and it was in Gomal Valley, and here we can see microliths also and domesticated cattle. Rahman Dairy, and the most important feature of the Rahman Dairy is that here we can see a transition from the Neolithic to the Cordillian phase of Indus Valley civilization, and also we can see certain fortified villages connecting with the Indus Valley civilization. Amri is a pre-Harappan site in Sindh region, and here we can see certain handmade red pottery with the geometrical designs. These are the certain features of northwestern sites such as Mahargarh, Kiligul Muhammad, Rana Gundai, Gumla and Rahman Dairy, and finally Amri. And in this picture you can see mentioned sites such as Anjira, Mahargarh, Kiligul Muhammad, Rana Gundai, Gumla, all are highlighted. Coming to certain northern sites in Kashmir Valley, we can analyze Barzohom, Kanishkapura and Kufkral. While analyzing Barzohom into deep, we can see it was situated on the flood plains of Jhelum River, and the word meaning of Barzohom was place of birch. Birch was a tree, and it was the name based on the tree. And here we can see four periods of settlements, and the first two were Neolithic, and third settlement was Megalithic culture, and the fourth one was early historic one. And the distinguishing feature of Barzohom was mud plastered pit dwelling. Here we can see mud plastered pit dwellings. And other important features of Barzohom were well developed bone tool industry, burial with dog, hunting and fishing economy, dwelling pits, storage pits contained animal bones and stones and bone tools. And the most important distinguishing features of Barzohom were, one was the mud plastered pit dwellings, burial with dog and well developed bone tool industry. Next one is Kanishkapura, and it was situated in the modern Kanispur, and here we can see both the handmade and wheel thrown pottery. Also four successive floor levels along with the post also is a feature of Kanishkapura. Coming to Gufkral. Gufkral, the site known as the Cave of the Potter. And here we can see the transition from hunting to a food gathering society. As at Barzohom, in Gufkral also we can see certain pit dwellings in circular or oval shape. These are certain importance regarding the sites in Kashmir Valley. And here in this picture you can see certain important tools used during the Barzohom period or excavated from Barzohom. Already we discussed that there we can see a developed bone tool industry, hence part of that we can see certain pictures that is copied from Upinder Singh. And again from Barzohom we can see certain important potteries, and there used different designs, different shapes in pottery. Coming to the mainland India, we can see Koldiva in Balan Valley of Uttar Pradesh, and here we can see Koldiva is very important, and here we can see a cultural continuity from Neolithic to Iron Age. And the Koldiva's specialty is that it is a site where we can see the earliest evidence of rice. We can see rice imprints on the pottery. And also the overlap of Microlithic and Neolithic animal husbandry is a significant feature of Koldiva. Also we can see three varieties of handmade potteries such as net marked or cord marked pottery, plain red pottery and BRW pottery, that is black and red ware pottery. And such kind of three varieties of handmade potteries are the features of Koldiva, that is situated in the Balan Valley of Uttar Pradesh. Next one is Mahagra, near to Koldiva. Here we can see floors and post holes associated with the 20 huts were identified. The interesting discovery regarded with Mahagra is that cattle pen. And cattle pen located in the middle of settlement. And here also we can see some kind of rice evidences, and the rice husk embedded in pottery is another feature of Mahagra. Kunjung in Son Valley of Madhya Pradesh. Son Valley, that's a river valley, and there we can see Kunjung in Madhya Pradesh, and the settlement continues from 4th millennium BC, and here we can see the domesticated and wild rice, and it seems to have been a factory site specializing in the making of stone artifacts. That's a specialty of Kunjun, that is, the site seems to have been a factory site specializing in the making of stone artifacts. Next is Chirand in Bihar. Here we can see terracotta objects including figurines of humped bull, birds, snakes, bangles, beads, etc. Another specialty of Chirand is that raising of two crops a year. In a year, we can see there raised two crops from the cultivation of rice, wheat, barley, mung and lentil. Also, we can see certain evidence of beads made up of agate, carnelian, jasper, steatite and fiance, etc. In Orissa, we can see this site known as Golbai Sasan from Orissa. Here we can see handmade pottery with tortoise shell impressions. This is important feature of Golbai Sasan, handmade pottery with the tortoise shell impression. At the same time, in West Bengal, we can see a location named as Pandu Rajar Dibi. Here we can see handmade greyware pottery with rice husk impressions. So sometimes you'll get questions based on impressions. So in Golbai Sasan, we can see with tortoise shell impressions, and in West Bengal, Pandu Rajar Dibi, where we can see rice husk impressions. In the Western Deccan region, we can see the earliest farming community or culture as the Savalda culture, beginning with the 3rd million BC. Remember that this Savalda culture belongs to both Neolithic and later Chalcolithic period, and sites are found between Tapi and North Godavari River Valley. And the feature of the pottery of this Savalda culture is that they used wheels plus, and the color was chocolate colored pottery. That is the importance, or that is the unique feature of Savalda culture pottery, chocolate colored pottery. And the major site was Kaote, and it was a 20 hectare site. And in the Kaote, we can see the houses were built in oval or round shape with a sloping roof. And the bones of wild deer and domesticated cattle, buffalo and dog were identified in Kaote. Dehamabad was the another important site of Savalda culture. It was situated on the banks of Pravara River. And here we can see certain mud houses, some large and multi-roomed with herds and storage pits, etc. Also in Dehamabad, we can see a phallus-shaped object made up of agate was found inside the house. Next is coming to the South India. Generally, the period is classified as 2900 BC till 1000 BC. And the early Neolithic phase of South India can be understood between 2900 to 2400 BC. And the major sites were Uthanur, Pallavai, Kodaikal and Vatkal. And the distinctive feature of this South Indian Neolithic settlement were, it is marked by ash mounds. Ash mounds are created by repeated burning of heap of cow dung, and it marks Neolithic cattle pens. Already we discussed cattle pens in Mahagra. Similarly, in the South also we can see certain ash mounds. But this ash mounds is not common in all the Neolithic South Indian sites, such as we cannot see ash mounds in Pennar Basin of Andhra Pradesh. Regarding the mystery of ash mounds, first they thought that the first report on ash mounds came in 1830s and 1840s, and they described it as cinder mounds and were of volcanic or limestone origin. Later, this archaeologist named T.J. Newbold, he first excavated at Kupkal, and there he found the certain remains of pottery, animal bones and their rubbing stones, and identified this as a Neolithic cattle pen. Later, Robert Bruce Foote, he connected these ash mounds with Neolithic culture. While analyzing certain sites such as Uthanur in Andhra Pradesh, it belongs to the Mahabubanagar district in Andhra Pradesh. Here we can see a wooden enclosure of the cattle pen was rebuilt for many times. And also we can see cattle hoof prints found in the ash. In Karnataka, we can see the site called as Vatkal in Raichur district. Here we can see a microlithic industry consisting mainly of blades and lunettes made up of cherts and quartzite. There were also large flakes of basalt and dolerite. And the significant feature of Vatkal is that here we can see the earliest evidence of use of betel nuts, Arica catechu, in South Asia. That is very important regarding Vatkal. And also we can see certain marine shell and marine shell artifacts, and that indicates certain kind of exchange with the coastal areas, especially the western coast. In Karnataka, we can see another site called as Budihal in Gulbarga district. And the feature of Budihal is that it is a settlement with ash mounds, and it was excavated by K. Pattaya. And we can see here, in a habitational area, there were 10 child buried, both in pits and pots were found. The bones of domesticated cattle were numerous, and hence they came into a conclusion that they specialized in cattle rearing than any other domestications. And in this picture, you can see the locations Vatkal and Budihal. and Budhyal is a settlement with Ashmons. The next most important topic is Chalcolithic culture, that is the first metal age in India. Here we can see use of copper along with stone, that's why Chalcolithic culture. They also used low-grade bronze to make tools and weapons. They were mainly farming communities, and also we can see certain remains of camels, and people ate beef, but no traces of eating pork are found. Use of bricks was extensive during the Chalcolithic period of Harappa, but there are no traces of burned or baked bricks. The planning of the houses was simple, which was either rectangular or circular. In Inamgon, this site is very important. In Inamgon, ovens and circular pit houses are found. And regarding the pottery of Chalcolithic culture, we can see the most important one was BRW, black and red ware, along with OCR, ochre colored pottery. And in burials, they buried under the floors of house in north-south direction. In Navas, another site, children were buried with necklaces around their necks or with the pottery of copper. Analyzing certain sites, the most important one is in Rajasthan, that is Ganeshwar Jodhpur and Ahar culture. Ganeshwar Jodhpur, that was in the northeast part of Rajasthan and in the Sikar district and along with the Sahibi river. And here the pottery was wheel made and orange to red in color. And there were three periods in Ganeshwar Jodhpur culture. And the period one, there we can see hunting using microliths made up of chert and quartz. In the period two, we can see the beginning of metallurgy. Hence what we can see, many copper made metals such as 5 arrowheads, 3 fish hooks, 1 spearhead and 1 awl can be seen. And in the period 3, that is beginning with 2000 BC onwards, more pottery and more or hundreds of metal objects can be found. The most important feature of this Ganeshwar culture is that the mature Harappan culture had connection with this Ganeshwar culture, that we can see through the double spiral headed pins from this Ganeshwar founded in some Harappan site. Next is Ahar culture, that was situated in the southeast part of Rajasthan near to the Banas and Baraj river system. That's why this Ahar culture is also called as Banas culture. And in later period, features of Ahar culture can be found in some sites of Malwa Plateau of Madhya Pradesh. And three excavated sites are in this Ahar culture, that they were Ahar, Gilud and Balathan. And the most importantly, in Ahar, we can see the earliest possibility of iron tools in the subcontinent. Simply, the earliest possibility of iron tools in the subcontinent that we can see in Ahar region of the Ahar culture. And in this picture, picture number one, you can see Ahar, Balathal and Ganeshwar. And in the second picture, you can see Ahar, Balathal and Gilund. Coming to other sites, Chalcolithic cultures, already we discussed about Ahar culture, Ahar in Rajasthan, Balathal, Gilund, etc. The distinctive feature is black and red wear. Next one is Kayatha culture, located in the Chambal and its tributaries. The sturdy red slipped ware with a chocolate design is main feature. Malwa culture, situated in the Narmada and its tributaries in Gujarat region, one of the largest Chalcolithic settlements. Savalda culture, already we discussed as part of Neolithic culture, there continued in the Chalcolithic culture also, and it was in the Dhulia district of Maharashtra. And Prabhas and Raghupur culture, both of them are derived from Harappan culture. The polished redware is the hallmark of this culture. So the polished redware is the hallmark of Prabhas and Rangpur culture. Finally, we are going to end this discussion by analyzing certain important findings of this stone age. They are in Atranchikara, we can see textile printing, Barzohom, pit dwelling, Chiram, serpent cult, Bimbetka, caves of Homo sapiens, 500 painted rock shelter. In Navasa, evidence of cotton, Hastinapura, wild sugarcane, Inamgon, statue of mother goddess, Koldiva in UP, earliest evidence of rice, Bagor in Rajasthan and Adamgarh in Madhya Pradesh were the earliest sites for domestication of animals, Mahargar, earliest evidence of agriculture, Mibbedka and Adamgarh, Mesolithic rock and cave paintings, Vindhya rock shelter, first discovered microliths. Hope you guys enjoyed this session. This session was mixture of many materials, especially Ubinder Singh and other materials. And in the next video, we'll be coming with another topic from Ubinder Singh. That's all for the day. Please subscribe and share among your friends. Thank you.